Hello and welcome to this video on ratio analysis. Whether you are currently practicing in accounting or finance, or you're preparing for the CPA or CFA exams, this video is crucial for learning how to analyze the health of a company. So what's going to be so helpful about this video is that we're going to present one income statement and one balance sheet, and from that information, we're going to pull all of the different ratios. We're going to address liquidity ratios like current ratio, profitability ratios, turnover ratios, and important investment ratios as well. So first, let's take a look at this balance sheet that we're going to be using for all of these ratios. We have our current assets and current liability section, which is very important for the liquidity ratios. Then when it comes to the return on ratios, like return on equity, we'll be looking at net income over equity, or return on assets, we'll be looking at net income over total assets. So we're going to be doing a lot with these numbers in the balance sheet. But first are the liquidity ratios, which covers how capable are we of paying off our debt. First, we have the current ratio, which is your current assets over your current liabilities. If we think of the definition of current, it is the items that are going to be turned into cash or paid off over 12 months. So it's trying to show you how capable you are paying off your liabilities over the next 12 months. We see here we have accounts payable and short-term debt that total up to $10,000, and our current assets, cash, AR, and inventory are $42,000. Therefore, our current ratio is 4.2. This means that we are capable of paying our current liabilities 4.2 times. In other words, they could increase by 4.2, and we'd still be able to pay for our current liabilities. Another similar formula is our working capital equation. This is simply subtracting out the current liabilities instead of dividing them. So we're just taking 42,000 minus 10,000, and that gives us 32,000. This tells us that after paying off our short-term liabilities, we still have $32,000 of working capital. So we have $32,000 that we can work with over the next year. So now let's move on to the turnover ratios. These are going to involve numbers from the balance sheet and the income statement. Turnover ratios are going to measure the efficiency of a company because it's trying to figure out how many times you get rid of an asset in a year. So for AR, for example, how many times do we collect our AR balance in a year? So the more times it turns over, the quicker you are at collecting your AR. With inventory, for example, the fewer times it turns over, it means we have very slow moving inventory. So we're selling it very slowly and we're not being efficient. So the higher the turnover ratio, the better. So let's look at this AR turnover ratio. So the name of the turnover ratio tells you what's in the denominator. And the numerator is the income statement item that causes this balance sheet item to change. So when we make a sale on credit, we are going to credit our credit revenue, credit sales, and we're going to debit accounts receivable. So we can see that accounts receivable is 10,000 and our net sales are 102,000. So we're assuming that all of these sales are credit sales. This means that we sell 102,000 in the year on credit and we have an average balance of 10,000, meaning that we have collected our AR 10.2 times throughout the year. Now, this is the number of times it turns over in the year. We can also say how many days it takes to turn over, which is the days in AR ratio. We simply take 365 divided by the AR turnover ratio, and this is going to tell us that every 35.78 days, we collect our AR balance. So you can tell that the higher this is, the quicker you're going to be collecting it, so the fewer the days it would take to collect it. So you want a higher turnover ratio and you want fewer days in AR so you're collecting it more efficiently. Now, inventory turnover works in a very similar way. Inventory goes in the denominator and it's cost of goods sold that goes in the numerator. So we have 30,600 here. Because when we sell something, we debit cost of goods sold and we credit our inventory. So this means for the year, we had total cost of goods sold expense of 30,600. And our inventory balance is 12,000, meaning that we sold our inventory 2.55 times. And we could easily convert this into the days in inventory by dividing 365 by the 2.55 to see how many days on average it takes us to sell our inventory.
How's it going, everyone? My name is Christopher Souza, and I recently just passed four parts of the CPA exam. Maxwell CPA review course absolutely changed my life. I was tired of failing. I mentally just could not do it anymore, and I knew that I was smart enough to pass this exam. So I 1000% recommend Maxwell CPA review course. If it was not for him, I would have never passed the exam. Thank you, Kyle.
So next we have the profitability ratios, and we only need the income statement for this. We're trying to figure out how much of our revenue turns into net income or into gross profit. So first let's look at the profit margin ratio. This is trying to figure out for every $1 of sales, how much becomes net income. So we're first starting out with the top of the income statement and then looking at the bottom of it and seeing how much turns into net income. So we can see that we have 102,000 of net sales and we have 49,500 of net income. So we have 48.5%. This means that for every $1 of sales, we have $48.50 of profit. We can also look at the other way with expenses, meaning that if we keep $48.50, then it means that for every $1 of revenue, we have 51.5 cents of expenses. So you can just take the inverse to see what percentage you have of expenses. Then we have the gross profit margin, which only focuses on this part of the income statement. So gross profit is your revenue minus your cost of goods sold, 71,400. So it means just looking at how much our inventory costs us to sell, how much are we profiting before we look at all of our other expenses. So here we see that we have 102,000 still of revenue and it turns into 71,400 of gross profit. So for every $1 we sell, we keep 70 cents as gross profit. In other words, our cost of goods sold is 30% of our revenue. So these help us to break apart our income statement to see where we're profitable, how profitable we are, and how much we're spending on expenses.
So at this point, let's address a few quick tips that can help you with ratio analysis. The first is remembering what goes in the numerator versus the denominator. So if you have a ratio name like debt to equity, it just directly tells you. That means debt is in the numerator and equity is in the denominator. If you have a turnover ratio, the name of it tells you what's going to go in the denominator. So inventory turnover, inventory is in the denominator, and the numerator is going to be the income statement item that causes our inventory to change, meaning our cost of goods sold expense. So cost of goods sold divided by inventory. In the same way, AR turnover, accounts receivable goes into the denominator, and your credit sales goes into the numerator. The next thing to know is that when you have balance sheet accounts in ratios, if you're given beginning and end of year numbers, you should take the average for those balance sheet items. So if you're given beginning and end of year AR, add them both up and divide them by 2 to find the average. But if you're just given the end of year number, then just use that number. And the last element, it's really important to understand what causes a ratio to increase versus decrease. So just imagine the inventory turnover ratio, cost of goods sold over inventory. So think of it as if the ratio is being squeezed at all, then it decreases. So that can mean either the numerator is decreasing, like cost of goods sold, or the denominator is increasing, like inventory. Now, if they are both increasing or decreasing, we can't tell what proportion they're changing by, so we don't know. So it has to be one is staying the same, and then the denominator is increasing, or the numerator is decreasing. And then if the ratio is going to increase, then you either need the numerator to increase, like cost of goods sold, or the denominator to decrease, like inventory. So this is how you can picture whether a ratio is being squeezed and decreasing, or expanding and increasing.
Now we move on to these additional profitability ratios with the return on ratios. These are trying to show us how much our major classes of balance sheet items are creating of net income. So return on assets, the name tells you it goes in the denominator, and return means net income. So it's trying to show you
For every $1 of total assets, how much are we generating of net income? So here we see 49,500 divided by 107,000. This means that for every $1 of assets, we are generating 46.3 cents of net income. This is important to measure because if you're getting a very good return on assets like we are here, then maybe we want to invest more into our assets. So maybe we want to purchase more fixed assets because our assets are working very effectively for us and generating a lot of net income. Or if this is very low, then maybe our investments into our assets are not worth it. And then we have the return on equity ratio. So within equity, we have the common stock we've issued, and we have the retained earnings, which are the earnings we've kept in the company. And we're trying to figure out how much money that's helping us to generate. So here we have net income again of 49,500 and total equity of 70,000. So for every $1 that we keep in equity, we make 70.7 cents of net income. So how could you change this? If you wanted more equity, you could issue more stocks, or you could keep more money as retained earnings. Or if you wanted to reduce equity, then you could pay out more dividends to your stockholders. So we have to see how profitable our equity is to see what decisions to make about equity. Next, we have our debt ratios, which try to show us how dependent we are on debt, how leveraged we are. When we think about the balance sheet formula, our assets equal liabilities plus equity. So all of our assets either come from liabilities of taking out debt or equity, which is us earning money as a company or issuing shares in the company. So first we have total debt to total assets. So this is simply all of your liabilities divided by all of your assets. So we can see we have 37,000 of liabilities and 107,000 of assets. This is telling us that our liabilities are making up 34.6% of our assets. So the inverse is true of the equity. So if liabilities make up 34.6% of assets, then it means that our equity makes up the 65.4% of our assets. So it helps us see, are we more dependent on debt or on equity? And then debt to equity is a similar ratio, but it's more focused on the ratio of debt to equity. So we have 37,000 of debt and 70,000 of equity. So we're just saying that for every $1 of equity that we have 52.9 cents of debt. So these help us to analyze whether we want to be more dependent on debt than equity or vice versa. And the last category of ratios are the investment ratios. So these aren't analyzing a company for how well it's performing. It's analyzing how good of an investment it would be to buy stock in this company. So first we have earnings per share. This is trying to measure for every one share that's outstanding in the company, how much net income is attributable to that share. So let's just imagine that the company has 1,000 shares outstanding, and its net income is $49,500. This means that every year, the company is making $49.50 per shareholder. So if the company were to distribute all of its earnings each year, then every shareholder would earn $49.50. We can then pair this with the price-to-earnings ratio to see if it's a worthwhile investment. So let's imagine that it costs $250 per share. So price to earnings is going to divide the price of the stock, 250, by the earnings per share. And this tells you how long it would take you to recover your investment in this company. Because if you're making $49.50 per year and it costs you $250, then it'll take you 5.05 years to recover your investment in the company. So the lower the price to earnings ratio is, the better. So you could also compare this company's price to earnings ratio to the industry standards and make the best investments possible. So now we've gone through all the key ratios you need to analyze a company. Now, ratio analysis is not just about finding a number, it's about telling a story with that number to tell how efficient a company is or how profitable a company is. So the more you can attach a number to an actual narrative, the more useful the analysis is going to be. Thanks for watching.